This incredible creature is a moth caterpillar, and it's doing one of the most important things any insect or animal in an ecosystem can do. As plant consumers, caterpillars unlock nutrients locked up in leaves and convert it to usable energy that millions of animals, from birds to wasps, depend on. Of course, that means besides eating leaves, the other thing a caterpillar tries to do is avoid being eaten themselves. They have some incredible features and behaviors to help them stay alive. And in this video, I want to show you some of those and highlight some of the incredible caterpillar diversity I've been able to find in my own backyard and that you might be able to find in yours too. First up is this, a salt marsh caterpillar. Salt marsh caterpillars are one of the woolly worm or woolly bear types that are covered in a dense set of long protective hairs. I found this one on a patch of blackberry, and that's what I raised it on and filmed time-lapse sequences of it eating here in the lab. I imagine being covered in long, spiky hairs while feeding on a densely thorned plant is a pretty good strategy for staying out of harm's way. Once this one finished feeding, it dug down into some soil and spun this cocoon. It'll stay in that over winter and then emerge as an adult. When it emerges as an adult, it'll be a white tiger moth that looks very similar to this one, a Virginian tiger moth, which is a closely related species. In comparison to the earlier caterpillar stages, the winged part of a moth's life is brief. Most of its life's work of plant digesting, growing, and evading predators is over. As an adult, it flies off to live a different, much shorter life in a completely different body. The caterpillars that might go to the most extreme lengths to defend themselves are slug moth caterpillars like this one, the monkey slug. In its final larval stage, which you see here, it arms itself with densely haired appendages, some of which it can use to inject a defensive venom into anything that attempts to eat it. Watch its reaction here when I touch it with some metal forceps. Instead of moving away, it leans into the touch with those appendages to try to stick whatever just came at it. Younger versions of this caterpillar, here you see one molting from one stage to another, are also covered in venom-injecting spines, but they don't have that same hairy appearance that the final stage does. This one, after it molts, partially consumes the old cuticle it just shed. When they feed on leaves, they can eat a bunch of different plants. The ones I filmed for this video were eating persimmon and hickory leaves. Now the common name for this type of caterpillar, a slug caterpillar, comes from how they move. Instead of having stubby prolegs on the underside of their abdomens, the whole abdomen attaches to the substrate like a slug, and an undulating wave of that underside glides them along as they move. You can see that movement strategy a little clearer with this slug caterpillar, one called a stinging rose. In this shot, you can see that they still have three pairs of legs, like other caterpillars, but the legs only briefly touch the ground or are completely off the ground when the caterpillar is moving. With their fleshy, spine-covered appendages and their bright orange coloration, to me they look like a nudibranch or a sea slug as much as they look like a caterpillar. Their bright colors likely serve as a warning sign for the painful, stinging spines. These ones overwinter in the pupal stage, so I wasn't able to rear them to adults yet. But I was able to film some other adult slug moths, these spiny oak slugs. They look very similar in the adult stage to what a stinging rose caterpillar develops into. Now, not all caterpillars defend themselves with hairs and venoms. Some, like the snout moth caterpillar on a mulberry leaf, uses the leaves themselves for protection while they feed. They're usually not out in the open like you see here. Instead, they're like this, in between a folded over leaf that they've stitched together by spinning silk threads between the two sides. If you watch here closely, you can see this one laying down these silk threads. The caterpillar will stay in this protective leaf tent, hidden away from danger, while eating away at the leaf tissue it's surrounded by. Another strategy for protection while exposed on a leaf is a strength in numbers tactic, like what you see here. Now, these are not moth or butterfly caterpillars. These are actually sawfly larvae. Sawflies are closely related to wasps, but here, in their larval stage, they look and act a lot like caterpillars. One difference between true caterpillars and sawfly larvae is that prolegs running down the abdomens of sawflies are much poorer at gripping leaf surfaces. So, sawflies grip leaves with their three pairs of legs and hold their abdomens up and wave them around if they're disturbed. Feeding together as a collective group means they're better protected individually and also that they can make quick work of a leaf. Here you see them feeding on a birch, eventually stripping it down to nearly nothing before moving down the stem to find another leaf to devour. Swallowtail butterflies, like this spicebush swallowtail, have some unique anti-predator adaptations. For instance, that black spot near the head is paired with another one on the other side to form what is thought to mimic the eyes of a snake to scare off vertebrate predators. This one also visually mimics bird droppings as a form of camouflage. This butterfly, a pipevine swallowtail, with its tentacle-like fleshy projections, looks kind of like a tropical velvet worm. In this next shot, you'll see my finger come in and touch its back. In response to that, it inflates a structure called the osmeterium. This aversible gland contains volatile defensive chemicals which repel potential predators, including other insects. Now in this video, I've mostly mentioned caterpillar adaptations to avoid predators. But another thing driving caterpillar defenses are parasitoids, like these Eulophus wasp larvae. Caterpillars, besides being required fuel for developing birds, are primary hosts to thousands of parasitoid insects. These insects can develop inside of caterpillars and then emerge from them like you see here. This is a saddleback slug moth caterpillar covered in silk cocoons spun by wasp larvae that have emerged after they finish feeding. Here's an adult wasp cutting one open and coming out of one of the cocoons spun on the back of a hornworm caterpillar. So sometimes, despite everything being out to get them, a moth or butterfly makes it to the adult stage. And I want to show you what that looks like for this spicebush swallowtail you saw earlier in the video. As they grow older, they change to be more uniform in color, usually becoming orange like you see here right before they pupate. At this point, this one's searching for and prepping a spot for where it's going to hang inside of its chrysalis. Once it decides on a location, the first thing it'll do is spin a silk pad that it will stick itself to keep it attached to the vegetation. When this one turns around, you'll see it fit the end of its body onto that pad. The next step is spinning a silk girdle attached to the leaf and looped around its upper body. You can see this one doing that right now. If I slow down the time-lapse footage, you can see that it's not yet got the thread around its body. Instead, it's spinning it and holding a loop between its front legs and its head. It'll keep spinning that girdle loop over and over until the thread is thick enough to support its weight. Once it's there, it has to squeeze its head underneath that line and then lean back so its body is inside and supported by the silk harness. At this point, it's done all it's going to do as a caterpillar and is about ready to molt into the pupal stage. And here's what that looks like. As the larval cuticle is pushed down, you'll see white lines appear underneath the molt. These are the tracheal or breathing tubes being pulled out. They're also made of cuticle and have to be shed with every molt. With this one, I wasn't able to catch the exact moment the adult butterfly emerged, but I did get to film the adult shortly after it came out. So here it is. This is a sight you don't often get to see. A newly emerged butterfly with perfect undamaged wings taking its first couple flaps into the air. Of course, in this stage, it still has some ecosystem services to contribute, both through pollination and as potential food. So that's all the caterpillar footage I have for right now. I hope you saw something new and interesting in this video. I know I have. Thanks for watching.